Well, good morning, everybody. First of all, I'd like to start by saying a few words to the organizer of this workshop. Thank you very much, Luca, for giving me the opportunity to discover this wonderful city of Urbino. Of course, giving me the opportunity to present this work. Well, today, I'm going to do something a bit different from what has been presented so far in this workshop. Since I'm going to try to speak about microstructure, about the microstructure effect in multiaxial fatigue. And yesterday, Professor Sakane presented something about the effect of the dislocation structure on the fatigue strength. So here, I won't go that far in the scale. I will go to the scale of the brain, for example. And I will talk about crack initiation, not about crack propagation, only about crack initiation. So the causes of this work are Nicolas Sanchez and Thierry Balaluc from Bordeaux, Camille Robert and myself from Angers. And the main contribution of, to this work is the one of Raphaël Berchet, who defended his thesis last July, on this subject. Well, the title of this presentation is the competition between microstructure and defect in multiaxial fatigue, and more particularly in high cycle fatigue. We are all aware that in high cycle fatigue, most of the time, the cyclic plastic strain and the consequent crack initiation is limited to a few critical hotspots where some material flows. You can see here such material flows, some micro shrinkage pores here in the nodular cast alloy or here in cast aluminium alloy. It can be non-metallic inclusions, any kind of flows that promote the localized plastic slip and the crack initiation. Well, now, if we turn to carefully polished specimen made of a single-faced metal, the crack initiates due to many macrostructural factors. I give you a list here. It has been proved by several authors that the size and the shape of the grains have an effect. The crystallographic orientation of the grain has a strong effect. The degree of anisotropy of the crystal, the grain location, whether it's at the free surface or in the bulk, the micro texture, we'll talk about that in my talk, the grain and the phase boundaries, and the persistence seedbeds, of course, and many other factors. And something that we must keep in mind about high cycle fatigue, and something that was pointed out by Madon and June, is that the degree of heterogeneity of cyclic slip and crack initiation is a key aspect in high cycle fatigue. And it's exactly what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about degree of heterogeneity. And I'm going to try to be as clear as possible about the purpose of this work. First of all, I'm going to try to better know the local stress and strain fields in a polycrystalline aggregate for different multiaxial loading conditions and in the presence of defect. And in the second part of my talk, I will try from this information to reflect the Kitagawa-Takahashi effect. Am I able, from this information, to explain why, when the defect size decreases, for some critical defect size, there's no more an effect of the defect. So it's something that I want to address today. Well, for that, I'm going to divide my talk in three parts. I will go very quickly on this first part, and where I talk about the material, the condition, external condition, and the results. And I will, in the second part, describe the numerical model I use and the constitutive equation that give access to the local stress and strain field. And finally, I will show you a microstructure sensitive probabilistic model that can reflect the Kitagawa effect. Well, let's start with the model, the material, sorry. Well, the material is a very usual stainless steel, the 316L stainless steel, single phase material. This one is often used for biomedical applications. We have a mean grain size of around 14 micrometers and some equiaxed grain. Well, all the fatigue tests have been conducted on a tubular specimen that you see here. All the fatigue tests were conducted at 10 Hertz at room temperature and in air environment. And on each specimen, we polished here a flat surface, and on some specimen, we introduced by electric discharge machining a semi hemispherical defect. Well, now, when no defect is introduced, what we observe? We observe that kind of thing. For instance, here in torsion, you see many plastic activity in different grains, and if we take a closer look at some of the grains, we can see that the mechanisms of crack initiation can be very different. We can have transgranular crack, intergranular crack, crack that initiates and grow at twin boundaries. We can also have mixed cracks, crack that initiate at grain boundary and then propagate inside the grain. So there are many different ways for a crack to initiate. Now, we introduced some defects. You see here a fracture surface, the thickness of the specimen, the flat surface here, and the kind of defect we introduced by electric discharge machine. So, we made some experiments, three specimens per condition, and here, I go fast, we have the result we obtain, the fatigue-limiting function of the defect size in tension, torsion, and combined tension and torsion. And what we can see here is that the defect seems to be less detrimental in torsion than in tension. It's something which is well known in the literature. Well, if we look now at the crack path in tension, torsion, and tension, torsion in phase, we see that the crack propagates on the plane of the maximum principal stress. I'm not talking about the initiation. I will talk about the initiation later in my talk. So, I have some data, macroscopic data from this experience. And now, let's talk about how I'm going to model the microstructure. I'm going to do something very simple. I'm going to generate two types of model, the 2D model and the 3D model. I will use global tessellation to generate a synthetic polycrystalline aggregate that you can see here, that will embed into an isotropic matrix. And for the 2D simulations, we have more than 3,000 grains. We introduce 4 notch diameters. We have, as you can see here on this zoom, around 20 elements per grain, and we use the hypothesis of generalized plane strain. We also use a 3D finite element simulation with once again a polycrystalline aggregate generated by voronoi tessellation embedded into an isotropic matrix, 600 equiax grains, and we only here looked at 2 notch diameter without a notch and with a notch of 50 micrometers. It was a question of the size of the model. And what we are doing is that we study different grain morphology in the aggregate and different crystal orientation, which is representative of the measured texture. So in 2D, we get a 1 grain morphology set times 10 orientation set used for the 4 defects, and we applied 10 cycles. For the 3D, we generate 3 grain morphology sets, 10 orientation sets, and only 2 defect size during 10 cycles. Now, about the constitutive equation, we use for the elasticity, the cubic elasticity of a face center cubic crystal. You see here the coefficients. And we also use some crystal plasticity model. And thanks to all this, we can compute different parameters. We can compute the accumulated plastic strain, or the different stress components. So I start with an illustration of what we can obtain, for instance, here with a 3D model. So you've got this here, the tension, shear, combined tension, shear. And to show that the crystal orientation has a strong effect on the way the stress and strain fields are distributed, here we look at 2 different crystal orientation sets. If you take a closer look, you see that the grains have the same morphology here and here. And when, for instance, in the case of the shear loading, you move to go to this crystal orientation to this one, you clearly see that the grain that suffer the higher accumulated plastic strain are not the same. So there are a strong effect of this orientation, crystallographic orientation. And now, here, I keep the same crystallographic orientation and I introduce a defect. And no surprise, there's a localization there. Well, now, I'm going to try on the 2D model, with the 2D model, to show the results in a different way and to show the effect of the constitutive material equation used. So let's start with no defect. I assume an isotropic elasticity, and with no surprise, I found for this representation of the resolution stress amplitude, normal stress amplitude, I found the Mohr circle. Now, what happens if instead of the isotropic elasticity, I use cubic elasticity? Now what happens? You've got a strong scatter of the mechanical stresses and strains. And now, if I add the crystal plasticity, it's almost the same as the cubic elasticity. The differences are not that big when you don't have any effect. Now, I'm going to do the same in the presence of a defect. A defect here of 500 micrometers. I start with the isotropic elasticity, I got that kind of distribution. When I add the cubic elasticity, the scatter increases. And when I add the crystal plasticity to the cubic elasticity, you see here a kind of saturation for the shear stress. It's due to the model we use in particular. Well, now, if we look for two different loading conditions here, and for this constitutive equation, if we look the evolution, look at the evolution of the distribution with the defect size, you can see here you are close to a Mohr circle, and when you increase the defect size, you clearly see that you can have a strong evolution of the normal stress amplitude and a much less evolution of the shear stress amplitude. And this is very, very important to see. For the shear, it's exactly the same kind of results. Well, now I've got many, many data, many results, and I have to do something with them. I have to predict the macroscopic fatigue strength. And I'm going to do that by using a probabilistic fatigue model and by using the results of the numerical simulations. And my probabilistic model is the one based on stage one. I assume that the crack initiates when the shear stress reaches a critical value, a threshold. And I give to this threshold a distribution. For instance, this distribution with a scale factor and a shape factor. When M is big, there are almost no scatter. When M is small, we have a large scatter. And what I do after that, after having introduced the effect of normal stress, I estimate the failure probability in a grain. And then, according to the weakest concept, I can derive the survival probability of all the aggregates. I do that, and here is what we can find, for instance, in tension. So, in tension, I put here, I apply at the boundary condition the stress, the experimental stress amplitude that we found, the fatigue limit. And here I give you the distribution of the failure probability per grain for a shape factor of 6, for the distribution, and a shape factor of 20. And what is very clear here is that this shape factor controls the way the crack initiation is distributed in the aggregate. It's very, very important. And you see, as a defect is introduced, we can also see the effect of this experiment. So, with one parameter, I'm able to control the way the crack initiation is distributed within the aggregate. So, we do that for tension, torsion, exactly the same kind of results. And something which is very interesting. I go back to Mr. Fatemi's presentation of Thursday. He showed something very interesting. He showed that in a torsion, when the hole is introduced, you can have the occurrence of a crack here, and then the crack branches. So it's exactly what this model predicts. It predicts that in a shear mode, you've got a zone, four zones here, where the crack can initiate in a shear mode. And this was the observation of Mr. Fatemi. And we also, in our case, with our observation, observe that kind of behavior. You see here, it's a shear, it's a torsion test with a defect of 500 micrometer diameter. And you see here, at the initiation, you recognize a shear crack here and a shear crack here at the bottom of the defect. Now, I'd like to be able to predict the Pitagawa effect. So I'm trying to use my experimental data, my macroscopic experimental data, with a different value of the n exponent, of the shape factor. And when I saw that, I was a bit disappointed, because I see, as you can see, that here you've got the tension in green, red, in green the torsion, in blue the combined tension and torsion. And you see here, when you use a high value of the shape factor, it means that you have a low scatter of the distribution of the crack initiation, the Kitagawa effect is very sudden. But when you change this shape parameter, it works pretty well. It means that this shape parameter, which represents the way the crack is distributed within the polycrystalline gradient, controls the way the Kitagawa effect occurs in that kind of material. And what I tried to show you here is that from the point of view of crack initiation, the Kitagawa effect is nothing else than a competition between the concentration due to the microstructure and the concentration due to the defect. It's only that. Well, now we have seen that the degree of heterogeneity of cyclic slip and microcrack is a key aspect in ice cycle fatigue. We have proposed a microscopic sensitivity statistical approach suitable for ice cycle fatigue behavior. We are able to reflect the effect of microtexture, defect, and multiaxial effect. But of course, now we have a lot of questions open. What is the effect of the macro texture, the scatter, the mean stress effect? What happens if I change the geometry of the defect and its orientation? And as you can see on this picture, how can I deal with gradient of microstructure? That's all.